Welcome to our service. Let's pray together the Collect for Purity. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Reminding ourselves of the summary of the law. Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbors as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets." My dear brothers and sisters, the scriptures teach us to acknowledge our many sins and offenses, not concealing them from our Heavenly Father, but confessing them with humble and obedient hearts, that we may obtain forgiveness by His infinite goodness and mercy. We ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before Almighty God, but especially when we come together in His presence to give thanks for the great benefits we've received at His hands, to declare His most worthy praise, to hear His holy word, and to ask for ourselves and on behalf of others those things which are necessary for our life and our salvation. Therefore, draw near with me to the throne of heavenly grace. Praying together, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which we have ought to have done, and we've done those things which we ought not to have done. And apart from your grace, there is no health in us. O Lord, have mercy upon us. Spare all those who confess their faults. Restore all those who are penitent, according to your promises declared to all people in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may now live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, desires not the death of sinners, but that they may turn from their wickedness and live. He has empowered and commanded his ministers to pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardons and absolves all who truly repent and sincerely believe his holy gospel. For this reason, we beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that our present deeds may please him, the rest of our lives may be pure and holy, and then at the last we may come to his eternal joy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And let's say together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's listen to the Word of God.
good brothers, come meet one and all. Don't brag about standing or you'll surely fall. You're shining your light, yes, and shine it you should. But you're so heavenly minded, you know earthly good. No earthly good, you are no earthly good. You're so heavenly minded, you know earthly good. You're shining your light, yes, and shine it you should. But you're so heavenly minded, you know earthly good.
The criticism that some Christians are so heavenly minded that they're of no earthly good is a catchy turn of phrase, but is it warranted? The Apostle St. John the Divine would say no. And our passage today from the book of Revelation tells us why. Let's pray first. May the words of my mouth and the meditation in all of our heart be truly acceptable to you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. After this I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice, which I had heard speaking to me like a trumpet, said, "Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this." Well, after what? In order for this passage from Revelation chapter 4 to make sense, we have to back up a bit. In chapters 2 and 3, we get a glimpse of seven different churches. They had their good and bad points, strengths and weaknesses, fears and doubts, faithfulness and unfaithfulness, the whole range of human response to God. The last church is the church in Laodicea. And three distinctive characteristics about the city throw light on the words in the Bible. First of all, Laodicea was a banking and financial center. Second, it manufactured clothing and unique carpets made especially from the glossy black wool of sheep that were reared locally. And third, it had a medical school and produced medicines, notably an eye ointment made from a pulverized rock in the area. Now, it's interesting to me that the stern words of correction for this church's spiritual life and the call for its repentance are couched in terms that these three activities of the city are like parallel to. Their spiritual health is summed up with the words from the Lord, "I know your works, you are neither cold nor hot. Would that you were either cold or hot. So I suppose you're lukewarm, and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth." Very challenging words to the church. And then, in a single sentence with contrasting clauses, you say, "But I say to you, the irony of the Laodicean situation is brought home to them." So, in spite of their, fine financial skills and wealth, the Lord says, "But I say to you, you're poor and pitiful, despite all of your medical skills and medicines for the eyes. But I say to you, you're blind." And in spite of their abundance of that special cloth, they're naked. But in all of this, there is the grace of God. Because the Lord is calling them back to himself. He disciplines and corrects because he loves us. His scathing judgments are the expression of an affection that wishes to lead them to repentance and change. And then, we have one of the most famous verses from the Bible, Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come to him and eat with him, and he with me. Gracious, personal invitation, conveying the offer of the risen Lord to share with any person who will open the door of their hearts and allow the Lord Jesus to come in. It's not only the promise of the Lord coming into their lives then and now, but also an invitation that extends into the eternal reign in the new creation in heaven. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if you've never opened the door of your heart, I absolutely strongly plead you to say yes to the Lord Jesus and invite him in. Now, speaking about doors, we find another one in our passage from Revelation chapter 4. And after this I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. Now remember that St. John has been banished to the island of Patmos, a rocky island in the Mediterranean Sea that the Romans used to imprison criminals and political troublemakers. St. John is about 80 years old at this point. He had refused to worship the Roman Emperor Caesar. And so there he was, sitting on that rocky earth, and there before him, he sees an open door and looks into heaven. And at first, it sounds like what it sounds like. John looks up into the sky and a door suspended in the air, and through it he sees the pearly gates of heaven. Now, over the years, I have changed a lot in my thinking about the kingdom of God, heaven. Heaven is not so much far away, beyond the clouds, in the sky, but rather it is God's sphere of reality, which is a lot closer than we think. In fact, it's right here, close beside us. Or in the words of one author, things are not what they seem. So St. John was not transported to another place or time to see what he sees. For John, heaven refers to another dimension of reality that is right here, close at hand, intersecting what we see, hear, and touch. Another author says that heaven is seen by the opening of the spiritual eyes. And now I see the expression that those who are heavenly minded are of no earthly good is actually false. St. John, who is, in fact, really heavenly minded, is not of no earthly good. He is of the most earthly good because he sees the whole picture. Things are not what they seem. There is a lot more going on that meets the earthly eye, and it is very encouraging. Why? Because God is on the move. St. John is like one of those ancient prophets who is privileged to stand in God's heavenly presence to see and hear what is going on, in order then to report to his people what is happening in the earth to encourage us and strengthen us. So, what does John see? Well, lots of things that we can talk about. But what I think he sees primarily is the worship of God before his throne. The Lord says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. if you hear my voice and open the door. And when you do open the door to Jesus, it should naturally lead us to worship him. At the center of this scene in Revelation chapter 4 is the one who is forever worthy to be worshiped. The worship of God centers us. The word throne appears in nearly every chapter of the book of Revelation. Why? Because God is the center of it all. In worship, God gathers you and me to himself as the very center. The Lord reigns from his throne. The worship of God is the most exciting, healing, wholesome, and safe place to be. As Eugene Peterson says, people who do not worship are swept into a vast restlessness epidemic in the world, with no steady direction and sustaining purpose. You see, way back in the book, in the Old Testament, the people of Israel were often plagued by an enticement to worship other gods, idols, it says, on every hill. Even the Emperor Caesar demanded to be worshiped as a god. And so St. John wouldn't do that, and so he finds himself imprisoned. You and I know that idol worship, the worship of little gods, small g, is alive and well in our own day. Again, from Eugene Peterson, people who do not worship live in a vast shopping mall. And I suppose now it could be Amazon or eBay, whatever, where they go from shop to shop, expending enormous sums of energy and money, making endless trips to meet first this need and that another, trying out this war, driving that car, eating that meal, drinking that beverage, hoping that they will center their life and give it purpose. But the worship of God is the most exciting, healing, and wholesome activity that we can ever do. It is the most safe place we will ever find ourselves in. And so St. John writes this: after this, I looked. By the way, look is the most frequent command in the entire book of Revelation. You know what the second most frequent is? Of course, fear not. We obey the second by obeying the first, when we look at the Lord. And I believe we do that when we are in genuine worship, acknowledging who God is. We're not afraid, because we are in the place of perfect love. And of course, perfect love casts out all fear. Look, says John, the door in heaven is opened, and look, there's a throne. Meaning, there's a supreme headquarters. There's a supreme ruler, a gracious king. There's a control center to the universe. There's a seat of authority and power, the throne of God. If we fail to have spiritual insight, we just think that what we see is what we get. Then we will be afraid. From the events of life, like wars, rumors of wars, school shootings, extreme injustice, personal tragedy. If that is all we see, we will conclude that there's not a control center to the universe. Things are totally out of control. But John says, look, a throne. Not way out there, but close at hand. Look, a throne. John says it 47 times in the book of Revelation, meaning God is in control. God is in control. God's in control. Say it to yourself. God is in control. And what comes next in the passage is a further description of the scene. The one sitting on the throne is as brilliant as gemstones. Jasper, carnelian. There's a glow of an emerald, a rainbow. 24 thrones surround God. And the 24 elders sat on them, all clothed in white and had gold crowns on their heads. And there's flashes of lightning and thunder. And in front of this throne was a shiny sea of glass. Now, in the ancient world, the sea, the forces of the ocean, often symbolized the forces of chaos and evil. What St. John wants his readers to know is this. Before the throne of God Almighty, chaos is stilled. Chaos is subdued. It's as still as glass. Now you know, and I know, that there have been times in our lives where we have experienced chaos in our own lives. We know what it feels like when circumstances are out of control. They threaten to undo us and the people that we love. We feel the waves crashing in, and often people's lives simply come apart. Like a house on a shore busting up because the huge waves are coming in from the hurricane. Look, a throne, and before the throne, a sea still as glass. Do you need to see that vision today? John is telling us that chaos does not win. And I find it exciting that later on, when John is given another vision of the new creation at the end of the book, the first thing we notice is that the forces of the sea are gone forever. Only stillness. Revelation 21, I saw the new heavens and the new earth, and this, there was no longer any sea. It says to me, chaos cannot win. What else do we see? Again, lots of things, but again, primarily a worship service with an array of worshipers. There are these strange creatures like a lion, an ox, an eagle with wings, lots of wings, six wings each. Now, could we think of all of this as all of creation is actually worshiping the Lord? And they're singing a familiar song. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Consider that and the other worship song around the throne of God in verse 11. Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created. The first song is the song of the living creatures who sing the worship song round the clock. They praise God as the Holy One, and they deserve our attention because they resemble the seraphim who surround God in Isaiah's vision of the temple in Isaiah chapter 6, and then even in Ezekiel chapter 1. It looks in some way that they represent the animal creation, including humans, because one is a human-faced creature, simply one among others in the created order, alongside the king of beasts, the lion, the massive leader of tamed animals, the ox, and the undisputed king of all birds, the eagle. The song they sing is one of simple adoration and praise. We are meant to understand, as the Bible encourages us, that if the heavens above declare the glory of God. Certainly the created order, the creation itself, does too, and worships God in its own way. In the case of the 24 elders, it's a slightly different story. The 24 elders are a double 12. They represent the 12 Hebrew tribes of Israel in the Old Testament and the 12 Christian apostles of the New. And as I mentioned, creation as a whole worships God, but the elders, the people who represent God's people, totally understand why they do so. The elders say, "Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and power, for you," or "because you, created all things." And there it is, because. This is what distinguishes us as believers in Jesus. It distinguishes us from the created order and those who do not worship God. Simply put, we have been given the understanding, the insight, the revelation of who God is in Jesus Christ. And because of that, we cannot but worship. It's what enables us to see that there is so much more to life than what we can naturally see with our physical eyes. We too see that open door into heaven. We worship because we know that we are loved by God and forgiven through the glorious cross and resurrection of Jesus. We worship because we are grateful for the life that's in our physical bodies and in our spirit. We worship because it is totally what we are designed for. Worship with a because in it, as Tom Wright says, is what makes you and I totally unique in all of creation. The Bible tells us, verse 10, "And they lay their crowns before the throne." And I just want to add that when you and I come to church on Sunday morning, or worship as we are today online, we are entering a worship service that is already in progress. And not only that, as many or as few of us are on a Sunday or any time, we are definitely not alone in our worship. Someone once said that the act of worship rehearses in the present the end that lies ahead. St. John is telling us that we are presently doing in worship right now corresponds to what presently takes place at the very center of things around the throne of God, and which will continue forever. Daryl Johnson writes, "The single most reliable indication that our spiritual vision is clear is that we are a worshiping people. People who worship with their lips and their hearts, with their minds and even their bodies. People who worship with their words and their deeds. People who surrender everything, just like those 24 elders who lay their crowns at the foot of the one who sits on the throne." There is so much in this passage. But let's pause for a moment and reflect about our lives carefully and ask ourselves a couple of questions. Do we, in our private prayers and life, see the worship of God as central? What is the first thought that comes to mind when you think of these things and read about them in the scriptures? Do you see the very creation itself all around us, abounding in beauty, which lifts our hearts to acknowledge the Holy Trinity? Because God is so awesome and He is so, so good. You see, there's this delicate balance. And speaking of the created order, some have ignored the creation as totally irrelevant. It's like we're only passing through this life, making, you know, do as we get through this, you know, nasty, dark, and evil place. While on the other side, there are those who almost worship the creation and the forces within it. And this passage shows the balance. All creation worships God alone. And we too are called to recognize and give the Lord all of the honor, praise, and glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. John says, look, a throne. The Lord is here. Do you see? Let's pray. Oh, Father, again, we can only scratch the surface as we look at this amazing passage. And I pray right now, Lord, that you would give each of us spiritual vision. That you would, O Lord, open the eyes of our heart to the incredible reality that is all around us. That our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit reigns supreme over everything. Lord, I thank you that we are part of your forever people. Lord, may we have this heavenly vision so that we might be of earthly good. And we would pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's continue by praying together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And please join me in praying a prayer of thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all, for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts, we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Thank you for joining us. Have a wonderful week.